Hello, I'm back to episode number 398 of the TEW 2020 Challenge Run. This is going to be Raw for week 3 of August 2023, and it is the go-home show for the Raw side for the SummerSlam event coming up this weekend in Tokyo. Tonight's show we have an Intercontinental Championship match between Dudley, Davis and Sheamus. We have Batista addressing Rhea Ripley. Johnny Gargano, Ricochet, and AJ Styles in a triple threat match, as well as Rey Mysterio set to reveal the final member of the LWO later on tonight. And of course, we also have the fallout from events involving Cody Rhodes, Drew McIntyre, Sasha Banks, Kairi, Charlotte, all of that stuff, as the final stretch towards Tokyo is upon us. Without any more further ado, let's jump straight into tonight's show. We open up the show with Rick Boogs is the one in the ring, the assistant GM. He says, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Monday Night Raw. Now, coming up this Saturday night and Sunday night, we have SummerSlam. And we know that in the main event on night one on Saturday night, Cody Rhodes is set to defend his WWE Championship against Drew McIntyre. And now here I am, Dave's busy with other obligations later on tonight. I'm mediating the official contract signing for the WWE Championship match. Now, the one order I have got from Dave is that there will be no physicality in this contract signing or between Cody Rhodes and Drew McIntyre until SummerSlam. So without any more further ado, let's bring up our first guest. He is the WWE Champion, the American Nightmare, Cody Rhodes. Out comes Cody. Dapper suit, as always, he takes a seat. And he goes, and his opponent for SummerSlam, Drew McIntyre. Out comes Drew, he takes a seat opposite Cody. And Cody signs the contract right away, and he just pushes it over to Drew. Drew clicks the pen, and he's like, you don't look very nervous, Cody. You look, in fact, rather calm for somebody who knows that in just 5 days they're going to get exposed in front of the world on an international stage. You see, Cody, your entire career you've tried to be like me. There's no denying it. And you were kind of hoping that the reason why you'd wanted to team with me again is to try and keep me away from that WWE Championship because you know I'm the biggest threat on this roster to take it from you. Not only am I going to take that WWE Championship from you, Cody, I'm taking the American Nightmare. Everything that makes you you, the fan support, the adoration, all of it. All of it's gone. Once I, Drew McIntyre, unstrip you of that championship and put it back where it belongs, around my waist. And all this credit you can get for your such incredible career can go where it rightfully belongs, to me. And then Drew signs the contract. And Cody goes, well, you know, it's hard to argue a lot of your points, Drew. And that's what makes you scary. Like, I'm not going to pretend that SummerSlam is going to be easy, because what makes you scary is that you believe every single word out of your mouth is true. And a lot of other people could probably believe every word out of your mouth is true. Yes, you came back just like I did. You left and you came back and you won the WWE Championship at WrestleMania. That's all fantastic, but there is one other thing that separates me and you, Drew McIntyre. And I alluded to it last week. Is that your first ever WWE Championship match on a premium live event, you won. I know what it's like to lose. So, you come out here and you say that if you take this WWE Championship from me, that the American Nightmare, everything that I've built up over these last few years, is gone? Brother, you must be talking to some other guy, because as long as they believe in me, and I believe in myself, there will never be the death of the American Nightmare. Because I've gotten up from SummerSlam last year where I was beaten, where I thought I had my story finished at SummerSlam and I lost. I picked myself back up And you, Drew McIntyre, you never really had that. You never really lost anything. Obviously, you've lost the WWE Championship a couple of times, but I'm talking a big match. A match against SummerSlam, against me, in a personal rivalry that you made personal that didn't need to be personal because you think I've got an agenda. Drew McIntyre, my story and your stories may be similar in parts, but they are two completely different stories. Both can coexist in the world of WWE without one needing to be erased. But you've now made your bed and you've laid in it, so you've erased the biggest part of your story, and that was the fans that cheered you along the way and wanted you to reach the mountaintop that they were promised a decade ago. That chapter of Drew McIntyre's story, you threw that away. What and for what? For a shot at my WWE Championship? For a chance to end my story? Brother, I don't need this anymore. I've got this. My story is done. I'm now starting a new story. The story of the American Nightmare, Cody Rhodes, face of the WWE. And that story started back at WrestleMania when my last one closed. And I ain't finished writing yet. So you can bring your sword. You can bring all of that. Bring it to Tokyo. Because I'm bringing my whole damn crew. And I'm bringing my whole heart. Are you, Drew McIntyre, are you bringing your whole heart? Or are you just going to look for a way to, you know, cheat your way out of this one? Because after everything I did to get here and become the WWE Champion, you're going to have to kill me to take it from me. And Drew just laughs. He goes, kill ya, hey? Interesting choice of words, Cody. Because now, Saturday, SummerSlam, your funeral. Slams the mic down, storms out. And when he goes to leave, he turns around, he claymores Rick Boogs. Because he can't touch Cody. He takes his aggressions out on Boogs instead of Cody. And then he sort of leaves as Cody gets help Boog up. He's like, are you okay, Boogs? Boogs goes, not really, mate. I've been kicked in the head. Speaking of champion. Oh, both did really bad on improvised dialogue. We cut to Kyrie in her locker room. And Sasha Banks storms in. And Kyrie's like, hello. And Sasha goes, don't you hello me. What do you think you're doing, huh? Last week, laying me out with that championship? Huh? What, taking a look at my championship? What, you're cracking it across my head? Bitch. Try me. Kyrie goes, no, Charlotte shoved me into you. Like, Charlotte did it, okay? And I thought that you knew that Charlotte did it and not me. Sasha goes, well, I was heated in the moment, and I for once, I don't doubt that it was Charlotte, because Charlotte does do tactics like that. But me and Drew, we still have a problem, okay? Because back at Evolution, I beat you in that triple threat match with Rhea, but yet somehow you're still in this championship match. And for what? Because you're Japanese? Because it's in the Tokyo Dome, you're being gifted title opportunities that you don't deserve? And Kyrie goes, I'll prove to you that I deserve to be in this match at SummerSlam. How about me and you tonight, non-title, in the main event? And Sasha's like, bitch, you're on. I thought you'd never ask. So yeah, there's our main event. Kyrie saying against Sasha Banks. And we're going to kick things off in ring-wise with our Intercontinental Championship match. What the fuck's gone wrong here? Match plan. Oh, I said it for a while, Brawl, but said to... I fucking do this all the time. I've humbled about... Fuck, I've done this about 5 times all series, and the last 3 have been in the last 2 weeks. So I said this as a wild brawl, but said to go 18 minutes, and that's why the rating's so bad. I see. Yes. And also the finish. Dudley wins when Randy comes in and RKOs him, basically. And yeah, I've lost all motivation to discuss the match, again, because of my own error. So I'll probably have to run this, but I was looking forward to this as well. I thought this was going to be like a 96. I probably could have been, but I fucked it up. So, yeah. But then, yeah, Randy RKO's Dudley. He costs in the match. He goes, kid, do you think you're going to cost me my shot at the Intercontinental Championship, huh? Put you back in your place. I thought I got rid of you, huh? I thought you were out of here. but no, you're going to keep getting your nose in my business. Then he goes to RKO Dudley again, and Sheamus bro kicks him. He goes, what you doing, fella, huh? Last week you moaned when this boy, this fella came in and interrupted your Intercontinental Championship match, and you're doing the same thing to him, you fucking bitch. And Dudley goes, I had him, mate, like, what's the matter? Sheamus goes, and fuck you too, fella, you little runt. You know, you both want to fight each other so bad, huh? You both want a shot at this? The only way to settle this is a triple threat at SummerSlam. Bang. Sheamus, Randy, and Dudley, triple threat match, IC title, SummerSlam. We then cut backstage to Kathy Kelly. Her guests are Edge and Christian. And Kathy says, you know, Edge, you cut a rather, you know, interesting speech when you came back after Gunther took you out of Backlash, where you were talking about, you know, you thought this might be it for you, and now you brought Gangrel in, so we're on the Brood back one final time. Like, do you have faith that, you know, you three can get back on form and defeat Imperium at SummerSlam? Edge goes, obviously, you know, Kathy, when I came back in 2020, I didn't know how much longer I was going to be able to do this. This was ripped away from me over a decade ago. Out of my own hands, and I finally got the chance to end my own story the way I wanted to end it, and that would obviously recall reuniting the Brood for a big match at SummerSlam, and that's what we're doing this Saturday night when we take on Imperium. And Christian's like, well, you know, we haven't really had the best of luck against Imperium in recent weeks, but, you know, that's Gunther and Ludwig and Giovanni, you know, having the numbers advantage over us, but when we bring our old friend Gangrel back over, could have been any other guy, but Adam really wanted Gangrel. He really wanted this Brood reunion. So, you know, we're gonna run back, we're gonna party like it's 1998, and we're gonna put Imperium down and prove that our way is the way. And she goes, well, you know, since we're both here, Kathy, do you want to run a quick 5-second pose with Edge and Christian? And Kathy's like, well, I would love to run a 5-second pose with Edge and Christian. And he goes, well then, for the benefit of those with flash photography, we here, Edge, Christian, and Kathy Kelly, are going to hit a 5-second pose. And I hit the 5-second pose, and then Pretty Deadly booking, like, oh, yes, boy, yes, boy. Oh, I see. You call that a 5-second pose? Darling, that's just horrid. Okay, if you want a real 5-second pose, Kathy Kelly, you should pose with Elton Prince and Kit Wilson and Tonya Breeze. We are Pretty Deadly. Oh, Edge and Christian, we may not have been introduced properly. And she goes, oh, don't worry, boys. I know who you are. In fact, I was just about to say to Kathy, you know, since the Brood is getting a run out on the weekend, Edge and Christian probably should have another tag team match before SummerSlam. And perhaps that tag team match should be against Pretty Deadly. And Ellen Prince is like, you want to face us tonight? Oh, your wish, you're not going to even make it to SummerSlam looking like that, okay? You put on those stupid sunglasses and anything else that makes you look revolting, and we're gonna show the world that our way is the best way, like you just said. Yes, boy. Ooh. So yes, Pretty Deadly against Edge and Christian later on tonight. That is a dream match in any arena. We then cut to the ring. Batista comes to the ring by himself. He goes, last month, Rhea Ripley made her return from suspension. Rhea Ripley had been suspended for a month after assaulting WWE officials, among others, including Tegan Knox and Kylie Rae, who we haven't seen since. Then Rhea came back and she demanded to be put in the championship opportunity despite, you know, coming back from suspension and being punished. And she took that frustration out on Becky Lynch, who also just made her return to WWE. So, it seems Raw has a bit of a Rhea Ripley problem. And obviously, it's taking a lot to think about what to do, because Rhea Ripley is an attraction. Rhea Ripley is one of the top stars, not just the women's division, but the entire roster. And we tried spending Rhea in that. That didn't really work out too well in our favor. Now, Rhea, she's not here tonight. She's not come here, but she's probably watching at home. So She'll be able to hear her own punishment from my own mouth. And he takes his sunglasses off, looks into the arc, and he goes, Rhea Ripley, it's time for you to face severe consequences for your actions around here in recent weeks. So, and then we hear commotion as, like, Becky comes out from the entranceway. She's like, her music's not playing. Imagine she's on a crutch, like, her knee's still banged up. She goes, Dave, I don't mean to cut you off, Dave, but don't do it. Don't do what I think you're going to do. Because that, for Rhea Ripley, that would be the easy way out. Okay? Rhea needs to learn the hard way that you don't mess with people on this roster, especially not me, the man. So, Dave, let me at Rhea. And Batista goes, I mean, Becky, I can't, you know. You're out here on crutches, you know, your knee's banged up. You're not cleared. I can't let you wrestle Rhea Ripley. Becky goes, well, if I go backstage to go to the doctors, I tell the doctors to man up and clear me, then will you clear me for action? Batista goes, well, we spoke to the doctors earlier when we got you tested as soon as you got here. You're not cleared. Rhea smashed her knee up, like, pretty bad. He goes, but I need this, Dave. I need this, okay? I've been gone for so long. I need to remind the world who the hell I am. And you're not letting me do that. It's for your own best interest, Becky. I can't let you wrestle and you be injured and risk putting yourself out on the shelf for another year. I mean, you've been here for, like, what, a year combined over the last four? We can't keep losing you, Becky. Huh? He goes, weird. And to think of what you cared about this roster, I thought we respected each other. Turns out, I must have been wrong. And then Becky hobbles back up the ramp. She leaves the crutches in the ring poly, but hobbles out on her own power, just to try and, you know, be defiant and show Dave that she can walk. But, yeah, nothing actually gets announced in regards to Rhea, because Becky can't Batista off. But, yeah. He's now got another problem in his women's division. Speaking of problems in the women's division, we see Charlotte Flair leaving the arena. And Kathy Cole, like, catches up to her and goes, Charlotte, you know, it's like 9:05. What? There's still another 2 hours of the show left. Where the hell are you going? And Charlotte's like, Kathy, I'm royalty, okay? I come from wrestling royalty, so, you know, I get to do things on my own terms. And a little birdie just told me that Kyrie and Sasha are fighting each other tonight. And, you know, as the third person in that match at SummerSlam, I kind of have great interest in that. Okay, so I could stay and watch it and, you know, risk putting myself in harm against two people who want to fight me. Or I could leave, go home, get a glass of champagne, put my feet up, watch the show from home, and watch the two women who I'm fighting on Saturday beat the hell out of each other. I think we know which one the smart option is here, Kathy. And the child just walks out the door. Ichiban's Aoi Maekawa and Meiko Satomura defeat the Yoko Miko team of Yoko Uehara and Kamiko Takanaka. Aoi pins Yoko with a Crash Rabbit Heat. 55 for Kamiko, 69 for Yoko, 57 for Meiko, and an 83 for Aoi. This match served basically as a purpose to remind me that it's Battle Royal season at SummerSlam. They obviously have the Andre Battle Royal and the WrestleMania Battle Royals at WrestleMania. Because this is a big show in Tokyo, I was gonna do an Antonio Inoki Memorial Battle Royal for the men on the pre-show. It should have been on one of the nights, and the other night would have the Women's Battle Royal. Tentatively slated to be the Hana Kimura Memorial Battle Royal, because I don't know if there's, like, a Joshi equivalent of, like, Inoki that is gone. Like, I know I could do it, like, fucking Minami Toyota and all that, but they're all still alive, so there can't really be Memorial Battle Royals. And plus, I just think it's nice, you know, because it's Hana. So, yeah, at the minute, that's what I'm doing. But that name could change. But there will still definitely be the Antonio Inoki Battle Royal for the men. And obviously these four being Joshis will all be in it. Apart from maybe Mako, because there might be a Sendai girl show on the day that I do the Women's Battle Royal, but I'll probably just schedule the Women's Battle Royal to be the day that she can be there, so yeah, shouldn't be an issue. And then, Shinsuke, you know, another one of his weird videos airs how he's going to win the Money in the Bank. Bianca Belair and Montez Ford watching it again. Bianca goes, Tez, you know, it's nearly SummerSlam time. You're getting nervous yet? Tez goes, I told you, B. I got this. And he walks off. Bianca, of course, still less confident in Tez, but Tez is, he's very confident. He's just said he's got this for like the last month. We then come back to the ring. AJ, Anne-Marie, and Kelsey come out. And AJ goes, well, it's like less than a week until we're off to Tokyo, Japan for SummerSlam, okay? Now, a lot of you may not remember, but I kind of have a thing for SummerSlam. You know, I was once involved in a WWE Championship match at SummerSlam. It's true, look it up. But this is different. This year I've got to fight Roxy, little Roxy, you know. A little pest who's been, you know, trying to get our championship back off me, even though it's rightfully where it belongs, on the shoulder of the most revolutionary woman on this roster. You're welcome, by the way. And now she thinks she can go all crazy like I can. Well, that's not the case, Roxy, because if anyone knows crazy, I know crazy, and there's nothing you can do that can surprise me. Okay, bring it all. You grew up studying me, so your idea of crazy is the AJ Lee best hits. Okay? What, you're gonna come out here and you're gonna propose to me? You're gonna kiss all of my ex-boyfriends again like I did? No. You can't do any of that because you're not her. I carry the entire division, you know. But you are, you know, a lost little puppy in a world full of wolves, you know. Girls like Rhea Ripley, Becky Lynch, Charlotte Flair, Sasha Banks, Io Sky. The list goes on and on. Roxy, you're not good enough to carry that torch. That's why you were relegated to this championship. Of course, this championship, you know, it's the most important championship of them all. Now it's on my shoulder. But you're not cut out to be the best. You'll never be the Hall of Famer. You'll never be an idol to a new generation of wrestling talent like I was. You'll never be that. So when I expose you at SummerSlam, I hope you enjoy Roxy Perez while you've still got her, because at the age of just 21, the prodigy will be nothing more than a flash in the pan. Roxy comes out, and she just gets in AJ's face. She takes the mic, and she goes to speak, and she just starts laughing. She just laughs. She's like, flash in the pan, huh? Flash in the pan. Bitch. On SummerSlam, I'm gonna make you irrelevant. She drops the mic and just continues to smile at AJ. And AJ's like, huh? What's this? What you doing? Anne-Marie, get her. Anne-Marie charges at Roxy. Roxy fights her off. Kelsey charges in, fights her off. AJ goes to leave. But, like, Roxy grabs her and hits the pop rocks. And then Roxy stands tall. She actually took all three women down by herself. You know, love that for her.
Thank you.
Speaking of, I don't know. I can't even think of a segue. Why did I say speaking of? That's just my go-to whenever I see the anime boys on the screen. Yes, we're going to get the follow-up from last week. You know, Dio and Manny promised to train Sensei ahead of the upcoming title match against Scripps at SummerSlam. But this is just full Rocky 3, you know. Dio, he's our Apollo Creed. He's wearing the same outfit. Manny's there as well. Carlin and Saray cheering him on. And then we get the scene of Sensei and Dio running on the waterfront. And then jumping up into each other's arms. And then Manny walks up to Sensei after the training's finished and goes, "Sensei, if I do say so myself, you're ready. At SummerSlam, you're going to take that championship from that masked delinquent known as Scripts. And then, once you've won that, and we've got Scripts dead to rights, we can finally solve the biggest mystery of all. And find out once and for all who this delinquent is under the mask. Because we are the club of uncovering mysteries. And this mystery will be uncovered. Tagline pending." And he walks off. And then they all sort of just look at each other after Manny walks off and just shrug their shoulders and goes, "I don't know, give it to him, I guess." Oh! Okay, 99. This match gets. I knew it was going to be good, but holy fucking shit. Yeah, this probably should have been the main event. Gargano, Ricochet, and AJ. Triple threat match. Taster of what we're getting at SummerSlam, where there's going to be a partner in each corner. And it is Johnny Gargano picks up the win. He submits Ricochet with the Gargano Escape in 1722. And this Gargano Escape, it's fucking... he's got it locked in. Like, it's not just one. He's got it proper locked in. Ricochet taps, like, almost immediately. Because he's put some extra fucking torque on this. On this crossface. And Ricochet, he's got a vein popping out of his bald head and all sorts. You know, it's a bit unhinged from Johnny, really. After the match, Ricochet continues to tap out, and Johnny's got it locked in. He goes, "Ah, who's a loser now, huh? Who's a loser now? You're a loser." And Ciampa runs and goes, "Johnny, what the hell are you doing? Okay?" He goes, "We're even now. We're even. I got him." And Ciampa goes, I mean, I know he was a bit out of line for what he was saying about, you know, self and Candace, but, you know, this isn't you. We don't do this, okay?" And then Bronson Reed goes, "All right, mate, control your little mate, innit?" Ciampa goes, "Why don't you control your mate? You know, he's running his mouth, giving it lip, and then he's been given a receipt by Johnny. And now, why don't you watch him and make sure he doesn't run his mouth in the future, huh?" And then Bronson Reed shoves Ciampa. Ciampa shoves Bronson Reed back, and they get into a fight as well. And then their partners end up having to, like, stop them fighting. AJ and Finn, both just watching along on the ramp, like, huh? You know, guess we're also here. We have the titles. But, cool. We then cut backstage and we see Cody. He's got his bag. He's ready to leave. He goes out to the parking lot. Brandy's there. And she rushes up to him. He goes, Cody. She's like all panicking. And Cody goes, "Yes, what? What is it?" And he goes, what have you got to say? You know, you seem very, very desperate. Brandy goes, Cody, something's happened. And then they run off. They go to the remains of the Nightmare Family bus. Well, I guess they're still driving around despite it being defaced. And Dustin's there, on laying up against the side of the bus, just beaten up, bloodied, ripped shirt. Cody goes, Dustin, respond, are you responding? Kathy's there, like, calling along ambulance and just, like, trying to get on the case. Dustin goes, Cody, you have to win when at SummerSlam. And Cody goes, oh. That son of a bitch. He turns to the camera and he goes, I know exactly who did this. And he storms off. And Brandy goes, Cody, wait. And then we see Dustin getting helped up onto a stretcher. Like he's getting taken to the doctor's room. 73. okay, sure, whatever. It is the first, we finally get the singles match, Zelina Vega against Beatrice Vargas. And it is Zelina who wins. I couldn't really justify beating her with Beatrice, who's got no pop. She does get a 56, which is really good for the little popularity she does have. But Zelina does pick up the win in 9:56 with a roll-up, so you know it is still kind of like fluky. 76 for Zelina, 56 for Beatrice. And yeah, 73 for the match, which I guess with those ratings is good. But then after the match, of course, because it was a roll-up, Zelina celebrates, but Beatrice jumps her like right away. Continues to attack her. Imagine Ray and Cruz rush into the ring. Jorge and Roosh rush in, as well as Dominik, yeah. What the fuck can I think of Dom? Yeah. And then Ray, Andrade, Cruz are fighting off. It's 3-on-3 because, you know, Santos isn't on Raw. So it's pretty much a fair fight until, you know, Conan gets involved. He low blows Ray or some shit. And then all of a sudden, LA Extreme have the upper hand.
I spit in the face of people who don't want to be cool.
Brent out storms Carlito. He storms out. He's wearing an LWO shirt. He storms out from the back. He takes a bite of an apple halfway down the ramp, and he comes into the ring. He gives a backstab at a Dom, and then Andrade and takes out Roosh. Cruz takes out Jorge, and then Conan gets out of sight, and then Dominik takes a 619. But then as he takes the 619, instead of falling down, he like staggers back, and Carlito hits a backstabber on Dominik, and Carlito raises the arms of the other members of the LWO, so he is the fourth man. It will be Rey Mysterio, Andrade, Cruz del Toro, and Carlito taking on Dominik, Mysterio, Roosh, Jorge Santana, and Santos Escobar at SummerSlam. He debuted his cool gimmick. Yeah. Got a very good rating. That's good. Okay. Okay, see what he can do. I'm not sure how he is in the mod, because this is like a fairly old mod, obviously, and they might not have rated him that highly. We'll see how he does. But, of course, I'm giving Carlito a run. If he's getting one in real life, which he's supposed to be, then, yeah, I'm giving him a run in mine. Except I'm actually going to debut him. We then see the doctor's office. Dustin's there on a bed. He goes, how's he looking, Doc? He goes, you know, it's a couple of bad cuts. You know, he might need some stitches. But all in all, there should be nothing too serious. He goes, thanks. And he turns to the hard cam and he goes, really? Is this how desperate you were? And to think I used to think of you as a friend, Drew. But here you are. You can't put your hands on me until SummerSlam. You're going to attack my brother? Huh? Someone who's got nothing to do with any of this? For what? To play mind games? I don't need to play mind games. The only game I need to play is bouncing your head off the canvas this Saturday night. Because before, you know, I felt betrayed. I felt a lot of different things, Drew. But now you've pissed me off. See you in Tokyo. And he storms off. 82, we love that. We love a pretty deadly banger. Edge and Christian do pick up the win, though, sadly, when Christian pins Elton Prince with a spear. 61 for Kit, 58 for Elton, 83 for Christian, and 90 for Edge. Yeah. Edge and Christian pick up the win. They've got Gangrel in their corner at SummerSlam, taking on Imperium. Should be a hoot. I don't even know if the match will be that good, because it's going to have Gangrel in it, but it'll be fun. And we now know the final matches from the Raw side for the SummerSlam card, including Raw's main event and Night 1's main event. Cody Rhodes defends the WWE Championship against Drew McIntyre. You know, a rivalry kicking off from that turn a couple of weeks ago, turned very personal recently. Who's going to leave Tokyo with the gold? We've got to wait 5 days to find out. And after his return earlier on tonight, Carlito is confirmed as the fourth member of the LWO at SummerSlam when him, Rey, Cruz, and Andrade face Dominik, Roosh, Jorge Santana and Santos Escobar with the losing team must disband. And we've now got confirmation on another triple threat championship match, this one for the Intercontinental Championship, as champion Sheamus defends against both Dudley Davis and Randy Orton. And the final championship match to be announced is the Cruiserweight Championship match, which will see Young Sensei get their rematch against the champion Scripts. And then, as we announced earlier on tonight, the men will take part in an Antonio Inoki Battle Royal. The Battle Royal will feature a lot of the names on the WWE main roster, probably some NXT UK names, not NXT UK, NXT Japan names, as well as, you know, any other, you know, New Japan alumni I can get my hands on. And then for the women, we've got the same, the Hana Kimura Memorial Battle Royal involving most of the WWE roster that's not booked currently, as well as names from NXT Japan. 88, that's good, but compared to that 99 rated triple threat match earlier on tonight, you know, it's a little bit of a letdown. But Kyrie pinned Sasha clean. 735 by pinfall with the insane elbow. 91 for Sasha, 93 for Kyrie. I don't often like just beating the champion straight up like this, but I think Kyrie really needed this. Because, again, like I said, she did get pinned back at Evolution, and she did sort of feel like a third wheel in the whole thing. So I just needed to give her this big, massive win to give her the momentum heading into SummerSlam. You know, if that happens on Saturday or Sunday, I can't remember what day it is, then we will have a new WWE Women's Champion. And that ends the show, but we do have one final scene. We're outside the building and Becky storms out. And she grabs a hold of the camera and goes, "Give me that camera." She goes, "Rhea, on second thought, cancel your plans this weekend. I'll see you in Tokyo." Slams the camera down. And then that's how the show goes off the air. And then after the show, it will be announced, like, on social media that Becky didn't officially get cleared, but Becky and Rhea will have an unsanctioned match at SummerSlam because of it. She sort of left that part out, but yeah. Becky Lynch and Rhea Ripley unsanctioned, because, you know, then WWE won't be liable for any injuries that may happen for someone who's not cleared to be wrestling. And that ends the Go Home episode of Raw. Gets a 93, had a 99 rated match. We love that. And yeah, time for the go-home episode of Heat. Heat kicks off with a quick singles match. Well, not even that quick, 8 minutes. Sonya, you know, she had that banger main event of Asuka last week and she lost. So, you know, I want to give her a win because she did well in that match. So she gets rewarded around here. She gets a win over Chikara Jackson in 8 minutes and 8 seconds by submission. 21 for Chikara, 77 for Sonya. And yeah, just a rebound win for Miss Sonya Deville. 64 rated tag team match. Again, I'm going to give Alexa and Nikki another win. Nikki still has, like, very cold momentum, even though, like, I rate her major success in every segment. But for some reason, because she got it when she got pregnant every, like, last year. And, like, nobody else did. But for some reason, she came back with ice cold momentum. And, like, it's really annoying. So, yeah, a win here should probably help build her back up. Alexa does get the win, though. She pins Karma and Petrovic with a Twisted Bliss. 64 for Nikki, 75 for Alexa, 47 for Sol, and 22 for Carmen. After the match, they grab mics. They go, "Oh, Nikki, did you see poor little Ivy on Raw this week?" And he goes, no, I didn't. He goes, "Oh, of course you didn't, silly me. You see, Ivy didn't see too much either." You see, Ivy's now a last little lamb. He's been wounded because she can't even see properly, and whose silly goose idea was that, huh? But it's okay, because those championships, you know, they're a burden on our Tatum and Ivy. And they need to learn the hard way that they don't mess with someone like me. that decision will haunt them for the rest of their days. And that Reign with the Championships only lasts until this weekend. But enough dwelling on that. It's time to go play. And then Alexa and Nikki leave. 37. Whatever. Yeah. I just wanted to just do this match for some reason. You know, I need another match to do. So B-Fab was recognizable and went, she could do with giving the rub to somebody. So Fallon Henley beats B-Fab in 4:49. 47 for B-Fab, 43 for Fallon. Whatever, it is where it is. We then see Bianca again backstage. And she goes, you know, I've accepted at this point, you know. Heat again, not Raw, okay. Batista don't know what he's missing, but it's okay because at least Brandy sees the vision, okay? She's got the EST on her show. And SummerSlam is going to be great when my ES team beat those next-gen girls. But, you know, I love the next generation, you know. It's just, I don't think those girls are it. They're going about things the wrong way, you know. There's a way to be respectful and become top. When I was breaking into this industry, that's how I got to the top, okay? These girls, They need to be put in their place. Hey, look, you, come here. She goes over to Chikara, who's walking past after her match. She goes, you did great tonight, you know. Keep it up, kid. And then Bianca walks off, and Chikara's like, thanks. You know, I really needed that. 67 raid main event. I've given the babyface team a lot of, like, 8 miles and tag wins. So just time for a 5v5 next-gen match. They beat Scarlett, Nightlight, and KC2. Nene pins Caden with a winning kick. 40 for Samantha Riggs, 46 for Nene, 40 for Lucy Stryker, 52 for Tracy Sharrow, 43 for Kathy Cole, 56 for Caden Carter, 71 for Katana Chance, 45 for Shantae Washington, 76 for Naomi, and a 79 for Scarlett. And so ends Heat's Go Home Show. No, actually some segments on this show, so it's actually kind of alright. But yeah, what matters more is what you thought of the show, mainly of Raw. So let me know what you thought in the comments below, and I'll see you next time for ECW's Go Home Show. See you then.